9876, testing, testing.
Okay. Did she say, say testing?
No, I do it my way.
You think I can't count the 10? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5.
Great, thank you.
She wanted to make it simpler for you.
I am a CPA, okay?
In 2003, these two men from Albany, Georgia, blew the whistle on nonprofit hospitals.
If you had an earthquake and the Red Cross came in, and then 2 months later, after they left, everyone got a bill that was marked up, 10 times too much, and then they sued them for it, we'd be outraged. But that's exactly what the hospitals do.
Charles Rayburg and John Bagnato discovered that many nonprofit hospitals, despite their missions to help the poor, were overcharging uninsured patients and often driving them into bankruptcy. These hospitals often claimed that they were struggling financially, but they were making millions in profits.
Wait a second, they got more money than Belize. Why do they need to be suing uninsured people or suing anybody?
At the same time, nonprofit hospitals were paying no taxes in exchange for serving their communities.
And here in Albany, we found exactly the same behavior.
It is not a big secret in Albany, Georgia, that Phoebe Putney takes care of everybody who walks through the door.
We wanted to let people see that Phoebe wasn't what Phoebe had said it was. We were the ones saying the emperor had no clothes.
When Charles and John went public, their own community hospital tried to crush them and discredit their discoveries.
The malicious attack that was placed against this hospital is not something that we take lightly. We want it stopped.
CPAs don't have too much excitement in their careers as a rule. I guess that's why there are no TV shows about CPAs. It's all lawyers, doctors, and detectives. But this is basically the neighborhood I grew up in. And I was born in Albany, actually, born at Phoebe Putney Hospital. Lived here all my life. My mom came from Middle Georgia, Eatonton, Georgia. My dad was from Cairo, Georgia, south of here. And they were, very kind and gentle people. My dad's, his actual gravestone, what we had inscribed on it was, do unto others as you would have them do unto you. And I think that's something they tried to instill in all of us as well.
I was born in New York, Queens, actually. My family's from New York. It was very much a traditional Italian family. It was kind of things you see on TV. Not the Sopranos. There's something about being a doctor to the Italian family that it was a major achievement for the whole family. I think that's fair to say. My parents moved south when I was a youngster, grew up in Mississippi, went to high school there, and went to college and medical school in Mississippi. So I'm really a southern person. Albany is an agricultural-based economy, more of a blue-collar kind of place. We're one of the poorest congressional districts in the country with a high percentage of Medicaid. It has, though, an industry base with big national, multinational corporations such as P&G, Miller, Merck, and so the town is not your typical southern town. Phoebe is the largest employer in the area. If Albany were a mall, Phoebe would be the anchor store.
So there's a recognition, perhaps not accurate and not healthy, that what's good for Phoebe is good for Albany.
At Phoebe, we're proud of where we've been, and we're excited about where we're going.
More than anybody else, Joel Wernick is responsible for what happened to Phoebe Putney, both good and bad.
Phoebe has a tremendous advantage in their area because of the two hospitals, they are the only one that has a certificate of need to do heart surgery and to deliver babies. And Phoebe, to their credit, in the business sense, they drive a hard bargain and they're able to pretty much dominate that community, healthcare-wise.
Albany Surgical is the practice where Charles and I work. Our business relationship with Phoebe stems from the fact that my partners and I do our surgery there. And I became chief of surgery there in 2003.
This is Ms. Israel. Dr. Bagnetto, how are you?
John joined the practice just ahead of when I joined the practice. He joined in September of 98. I think I came on board around the end of October.
Charles is a very competent and very honest guy, and he knows healthcare administration in and out.
What do they do with cost reports? Do they use it in any way to regulate hospitals, or is it just data collection?
It determined that, you know, the exact amount of money that a hospital would receive every year from Medicare and Medicaid.
I thought he was overqualified to be a practice manager, but our plan was to open an ambulatory surgery center, which then would require services of somebody like Charles.
We set out on a goal to open a surgery center. It was a good thing. It'd be good for our practice. It would be good for the community. We'd offer a new service at a lower price, and we hit obstacles with the state.
Georgia is the only state in the union that doesn't recognize general surgery as a single specialty and won't permit general surgeons to open freestanding surgery centers.
We sued the state health planning agency in our effort to make general surgery a single specialty. The Alliance of Community Hospitals intervened as a defendant against us. So there we have the hospitals we're working for intervening against us. You ask yourself, well, how many operations could they really do over here, and could that really impact a big $200 million a year hospital? It just can't. It's not really a threat. And so then it becomes, well, why do they not want to let you do some minor surgery?
Well, it's all about money. And with the hospitals, it doesn't matter whether it's a large amount of money or a small amount of money. It's all about money, and unfortunately, some of them want all of the money, and they don't want the competition.
The Alliance of Community Hospitals intervened on the premise that they would be financially harmed. Because they made that claim in court, we began to investigate the hospital's financial positions.
I knew that there was a way to get their tax returns on the internet. So in the summer of 2003, I found the source, and it was called GuideStar.org. The first thing I did was I took a look at Phoebe Putney Memorial Hospital, an extremely profitable organization. We've kind of described it as a reverse Enron, where the public companies are constantly finagling their financials to try to boost their apparent profits. And the nonprofits actually have the other dilemma. They need to publicly look like they have less. It helps them when they go to the legislature to look somewhat poor, and it helps them with their PR a lot to not look like they're real wealthy. And so they tend to look for places to put cash. Cayman Islands is one of them.
Their jet travel to the Cayman Islands is almost legendary now around Albany. They even chartered Johnny Cochran's private jet to fly down there on a regular basis.
Phoebe was spending about $2 million a year on travel for their executive and board members. That included things like board retreats at the Ritz-Carlton and Amelia Island. The chief executive officer had a compensation package that was about $707,000 a year, which in Albany, Georgia, which is generally a poor region of the United States, that's a tremendously large salary. The real benefit of being a tax-exempt nonprofit hospital is the tax exemption. We calculated on Phoebe Putney, the tax they don't pay is in the neighborhood of $22 million a year. You know, as Phoebe's become wealthier and wealthier, they've more and more property all over the city, and they come off the tax rolls, and that's one of the things that we think hurt our school systems here is that a lot of the property values have been taken off the tax rolls by some nonprofits like Phoebe. We decided at one point that after looking at Phoebe, that it would be interesting to look at, you know, the total of this organization, what they represented. Out of the 60, about 34 of them had a tax return on file that we could get.
We've discovered that 34 hospitals were holding $2.6 billion in cash. Now, I'm not saying in assets, I'm talking about in cash. I was working late one night, and about 3 or 4 o'clock in the morning, I woke up, and that $2.6 billion kept going around in my head. And I was trying to think, okay, there are 34 hospitals that have $2.6 billion. Well, there's 5,000 not-for-profit hospitals in the United States. If they're holding a proportionally equivalent amount, then that would be $2.8 trillion. And I kept thinking, I got a decimal point off. I got to have something wrong here. I woke you up. I said, Charles, you're not going to believe this. They got $2.8 trillion. And that's what really started it. We started looking like two crazy men.
He loves to lead the charge, prefer to research, investigate. I like to do things in the background. And I guess that's the way I've been all my life. When I was in school, I'd rather sit in the back of the room and watch everyone else and what's going on than be at the front of the class.
If you give me a rule, I'm going to question it. It's just natural. And, you know, I attribute it to my Catholic school upbringing. We had religion class, and the nun said that the Pope was infallible. Got to ask a question here. What about Pope Alexander, or whatever his name was? He had a kid, and, I mean, these people were not infallible. It's kind of just, you're out of here. Threw me out of class like an umpire, you know, throwing the guy out. It crystallized the notion of the institutions themselves create dogma or rules that are self-serving and self-propagating, and I think that's what's at play here.
People did not know what was going on in the nonprofit hospitals, and in Albany particularly, people did not know what was going on at Phoebe Putney. And so at that point, just really kind of on a lark, I took what I thought were the, you know, the 10 most interesting things that we had found, and I typed it up in a document that I just called it Phoebe Factoids.
They went out to local businesses. We sent them to insurance agents, lawyers, just pretty much anybody who had a fax machine and we could get the number. Well, there was sort of a Dennis the Menace kind of feature or aspect to it. We did get a little too cutesy at times. But the whole point of it was to get the information out. We wanted to let people see that Phoebe wasn't what Phoebe had said it was. And it was sort of like we were the ones saying the emperor had no clothes.
Finally, a newspaper actually reported this stuff. Perhaps it was the fact it was anonymous and people really didn't know where it was coming from. That, you know, that was of interest to some people, and people began looking up the tax returns, verifying the information, and it kind of started something in motion that we'd never had before, and that was community discussion about what was going on in our public hospital.
People are scared to talk about Phoebe because it may be that Uncle Joe has a contract for air conditioning over at Phoebe. Power keeps people silent around Albany.
As chief of surgery, I was sort of on the inside, not very far in the inside, but inside deep enough to know that we had hit a nerve and what we were doing was causing them some concern. And we felt that was good because, I mean, our whole modus operandi here was to
you know, comfort the afflicted by afflicting the comfortable. And, you know, we seem to be doing that.
When I worked in a nonprofit hospital as a CFO, you know, you're working with the organization at a different level. And the mantra in the nonprofit hospitals is no margin, no mission.
Hey.
Hey.
How you doing?
Fine.
How you been?
After I joined the practice, you know, we're working with patients on a much closer, more personal level. I really began to see that, you know, the impact that the hospital billing was having on the patients and their families.
Physicians, in my practice in particular, we always discounted our charges to uninsured patients. We never charged them full price.
In the course of our investigation into the hospitals, it turned out the hospitals weren't doing that. And in fact, the hospitals were suing these people. So these reports started coming out of California, Illinois, and so forth. And Charles and I started looking, and here in Albany, we found exactly the same behavior. You can go to the circuit clerk's website, and you see pages and pages and pages of Phoebe Putney being the plaintiff against people and garnishing their wages, so many of them are uninsured. They discount their charges to Medicaid. They discount their charges to Medicare. They discount their charges to insurance plans. So when I learned that hospitals were not just billing uninsured patients full price, but expecting them to pay and then suing them to get the money, it struck a nerve with me.
Charlie Bush stands over a table full of medical bills and letters demanding payment.
I'm sending out $1,000 a month in hospital bills.
But he can't pay these, even though he works two jobs, because he doesn't have insurance. Edna Bush lies in the next room visiting with family, weak from cervical cancer and the brutal treatments that so far haven't helped.
Who could pay these bills?
Well, I'll tell you what, the chief of staff of that hospital could pay it because he make a whole lot of money over more than I make.
The business practices of nonprofit hospitals, they're industry-wide, and they're not considered wrong. They're standard business practices. About 85% of the hospitals in America are nonprofit hospitals, and the patient population that they're dealing with includes about 47 million uninsured patients, and that's a number that's been growing each year. Something over half of the bankruptcies in the U.S. involve people with significant medical debt.
To go to my dad, my mother, and everybody else to feed my kids right now. So I'm a single mom. My last check was $150. My rent is $350. My utilities are $250. My child care is $150. My bankruptcy comes out automatically. I'm gonna probably have to have more surgery, and that's gonna be another bill.
So we now knew this was going on all over the place, and the question was, how do you do something about it? How do you change it? We had met with different state officials and so on, and everyone had an interest in what was going on and thought that there was, you know, that there were things that needed to be looked into, but no one seemed to have jurisdiction over it. And after kind of exhausting all the normal paths and the administrative agencies, Magnato was kind of mulling it over. What do you do with this? How do you fix it? And somewhere along the way, he had the thought that maybe the only people who can fix it are the trial lawyers. And if you were going to get a trial lawyer, who would you want? You'd want Dickie Scruggs, the guy who took down the tobacco companies.
The connection to Scruggs was from the standpoint of, you know, making this a national issue.
We researched hundreds of hospitals. We would try to look at nonprofit hospitals. They were mistreating, in our opinion, the uninsured. They were aggressively seeking to collect from them. They were filing lawsuits against them. We wanted to make sure that financially these hospitals were well off. So they had the means. They could have been charitable, but they chose not to. And they also had other problems that we saw, like, for instance, the excessive executive compensation. So we were trying to look for hospitals that had signs of bad conduct. They weren't good players.
When Dick Scruggs got involved, I think really fired a shot across hospitals' bows. I remember he gave a speech here in Atlanta. He was talking about another subject, but all the hospital groups were there, the very powerful groups. And when I came out and saw their faces, they were not very happy about that they were going to have to contend with this fellow who'd taken on the tobacco industry and won.
In June of 2004, the Scruggs team filed multiple lawsuits involving hospitals all over the country on behalf of uninsured patients who had been overcharged and price gouged by nonprofit hospitals in the United States.
I think it surprises some people that this litigation by Scruggs and this whole attention on the uninsured and what they're being charged emanated from a very small southwestern Georgia city.
I walked out of my office about 7:30. We'd been closed for a while. I heard a vehicle crank up in the alley nearby. It revved up. It came pulling in real fast, a Jeep Cherokee, and it pulled up behind my truck and blocked me off. These two guys, they jump out and they're calling my name. Charles Rayburg. Charles Rayburg. Are you Charles Rayburg? We're ex-FBI agents. We were retained by Phoebe, and we've been investigating you. And they went on to say that they've been working with the district attorney and that they had information from the district attorney that would prove that I had sent anonymous faxes about Phoebe that would incriminate me. And they wanted me to actually get in the vehicle and just leave with them and go somewhere to have a meeting. And they told me if I'd fully cooperate with them, that they would not prosecute me or sue me. And if I didn't cooperate with them, that there was going to be a very, very big, expensive lawsuit filed against me. And then one of them, the one who did most of the talking, what really disturbed me was he said, Mr. Rayburg, he said, if you're not smart enough to do this for yourself, you should think about your wife, Wanda, and your lovely family. As we were getting ready to leave, one of them gave me his business card. He writes a 1-800 pager number on it and said I had, you know, until morning to think about it. I went ahead and called that number.
Have you talked to anybody else in regards to this other than your attorney, Al?
I don't see any reason to answer that question.
Okay. Well, that's all I need to know.
The next day, Richard Langley, who I knew to be Phoebe's attorney, he presented to my attorney this idea of this immunity agreement with the admonition that it was a one-way street. There was no reason to sign it, and I refused it.
I felt really bad talking to Charles. I talked to him, within minutes of that incident, and he was quite upset and quite shaken by it, actually. He had never had anything like that happen to him.
There was a lot of concern for my family. We live out in a pretty rural area where homes are spread out and no close neighbors, and so Dick Scruggs hired a bodyguard, a private detective, to come and just watch over the family.
Scruggs sent Jim Bowman, a private investigator from Oxford, Mississippi, to watch over Charles and his family.
Every day he would check in with us. He'd want to know what our routine was going to be for the day, when we'd be coming and going. Anytime that we would leave and go somewhere, he would follow us wherever we went. He stayed very close that way. I primarily wanted him watching over, my wife and kids.
I love you.
Good night.
Thank you.
Good night.
Good night.
Sweet dreams.
Oh,
you're so sweet.
Good night. Love you.
Love you too.
Sweet dreams.
Y'all are the best kids in the world. Sweet dreams.
Good dreams. Don't forget to say prayers.
Charles got about 20 emails that had spoofed email addresses that were like from me or from people in the class action lawsuits that had attachments that he didn't open. And when you look at the address, he knows how to do all this. I don't. They were all from Phoenix, Arizona. And no one, we never sent any of those emails. And so you can't open them because it's, you know, our suspicion is that it's a keylogger of some description. But they're all from Phoenix, which Phoenix is where the FBI guys that Phoebe hired are from.
The dogs go crazy. And there's a difference in them going crazy just because, you know, they think they hear something. I mean, there are nights that they've really gone crazy. We've had, you know, really odd things. I mean, you know, the lights on the phone stay lit. Like, talk on the phone, you hang up and it doesn't go off. And you sit there and watch that light blink and it's like, wow. Or it doesn't connect right away. Or, I mean, there are things, really, you know, kind of creepy things. You know, the day I put the key in the lock and the whole deadbolt came out in my hand, that was not a fun day.
Jim Bowman, the private investigator, began speaking with Phoebe board members to better understand who was behind the threats against Charles. He went to the home of Phoebe board member Dr. James Hotz. Dr. Hotz is well known in the area because he was the inspiration for the movie Doc Hollywood. Jim Bowman recorded his exchange with Dr. Hotz that day. He could not have known that this recording would later become a critical piece of evidence.
Hey, Ms. Hotz. My name is Jim Bowman, and I work for the attorney that represents Charles Rittberg. And he was accosted by...
Okay, I can't talk to you. No, I can't. What's your name?
Jim Bowman. Do you work for the hospital, or...
You want to discuss the case?
No, I don't want to discuss the case. What I want to discuss is you know, the incident with the FBI agents, ex-FBI agents.
Who do you work for?
I work for the attorney that represents Mr. Redford.
Well, tell him that he will probably see me, too.
All right.
Okay.
Thank you, sir. You
have another one on board coming to my house like this.
Sir?
They say you may have another one on board coming to my house later.
Oh, okay. Thanks, sir. Another what on board?
Well, just think about it.
Okay.
Think about it.
Thank you.
When Phoebe found that it couldn't intimidate Charles into apologizing for the Phoebe factoids, the hospital filed a $66 million lawsuit against him.
These faxes... varied from being somewhat ridiculous to being absolutely scandalous.
The malicious attack that was placed against this hospital, the employees, and the administration, is not something that we take lightly. We want it stopped.
Phoebe, as far as we can tell, they had never sued anyone and held a press conference to announce it. And it really was apparent that they were trying to make a public statement that if anyone stands up against Phoebe, if anyone speaks out against Phoebe, that they're going to come down on them and they're going to come down hard. So there were sheriffs riding around trying to find me to serve me. Press people were starting to call. I hadn't seen any of it. I had no idea, you know, what they had in it truly. And for about two solid days, you know, I had a horrible time in the press.
It was $66 million was that first lawsuit, because it was $1 million per, and they had, you know, $66 million is how much it added up to. So after the first $64.5 million, it's kind of pretty much theory there. But, you know, they were trying to absolutely financially ruin us.
I'd actually begun talking with Andy Miller, who's an investigative reporter at the Atlanta Journal and Constitution. Once the Atlanta Constitution reported their story, I think pretty universally, just rapidly turned around. People said, wait a minute, you know, why is a nonprofit hospital suing a guy for $66 million for sending out faxes with information that's in a public tax return? You know, why would they spend all the money it takes to do this even?
I think the media coverage of the Phoebe issues is really pissed. I think the whole media piece is also a part of the story.
Phoebe Putney Memorial Hospital gets millions of dollars in tax exemptions as a not-for-profit hospital.
Phoebe Putney Hospital is suing over info sheets called Phoebe Factoids.
Phoebe saves well more than $20 million a year. Joel Wernick says local taxpayers are actually getting a break.
To me, I think the taxpayers ought to be smiling.
We're stirring up stuff that should be stirred up, and we're not stirring fast enough, honestly, because we just don't have the resources as a little mom-and-pop newspaper. The conspicuous absence on the business side with this paper is that Phoebe Putney, probably the largest non-manufacturing employer in the region, has it cost us? Yeah, it's probably cost us a good $40,000-$60,000 a year, which is a lot to a little newspaper like us.
Charles's reputation was called into question because of Phoebe's lawsuit against him. So Charles decided to file a counterclaim against Phoebe to clear his name.
And because Phoebe had asserted that the Phoebe factoids were lies and that I was a liar, then I had the right to ask for the documents that would prove that they were true and that I wasn't a liar. And so they opened the door to allow me to have all kinds of documents on all kinds of subjects. Pretty much anything that we ever touched on in a Phoebe factoid, we were allowed to get a document relating to that. One of the things that I found most shocking was the amount of money that Phoebe had spent on investigators and research trying to determine who was sending the Phoebe factoids. They spent literally hundreds of thousands of dollars on that effort.
One of the things that Charles and John discovered was that Phoebe had set up an offshore insurance company in the Cayman Islands.
Phoebe owns a company called Grove Point, which is domiciled in the Cayman Islands.
The hospitals will set up an offshore captive because they can provide a malpractice and professional liability insurance company to themselves. And it allows them to move assets off the corporation's books into another corporation, which is providing insurance. And if that corporation is domiciled in the Cayman Islands, then it allows them to set up subsidiary companies and put lots of money over there, and it's a secret. What they were doing with the captive was gambling, luxurious dinners in Bermuda, golf outings. They were buying sportswear on Phoebe's dime. And this was the board.
Charles's lawsuit continued to turn up new facts that validated the factoids. And with each disclosure, Albany became more aware of Phoebe's questionable financial practices. Phoebe soon dropped its lawsuit against Charles, but Charles's counterclaim continued to move forward. After 9/11 and the public's criticism of the Red Cross, Iowa Senator Chuck Grassley and the Senate Finance Committee began investigating the nonprofit sector. In May of 2005, Grassley began an inquiry into 10 nonprofit hospitals, including Phoebe Putney. He requested information about Phoebe's offshore accounts in the Cayman Islands from Dr. Charles Gebhardt, Phoebe board member and chief of medical staff.
I'd gotten a request from Senator Grassley's chief investigator. And he asked me for the information, and I sent it to him. And I called the chairman of the board, and I told him. He said, well, you need to give me the information of how you sent it and give me the trip number. I just didn't give him the trip number. Actually sent lawyers from Iowa to try to get this information, keep him from reading it, under the pretense it was a HIPAA violation.
Charles Gebhardt was never meant to be on the board of Phoebe Putney Memorial Hospital. He's probably the last guy that the Phoebe directors wanted to see around that table. He can't be intimidated. He's honest to a fault, and he knows everything about the medical industry. He's an MD, after all.
Senator Grassley's office, please hold.
You know, this is a request by the United States Senate of information. They have the right to investigate these issues. After all, that committee supervises the IRS. And if they have questions and they ask me for it, who am I to tell them they can't have it?
We consider today the issue of nonprofit hospitals.
During Senator Grassley's hearings, Mr. Everson, the IRS chief, gave testimony to Senator Grassley about how much money is in the not-for-profit sector, and he estimated it was $4 trillion, over half of which is in the hospitals.
Nonprofit hospitals receive billions in tax breaks at the federal, state, and local level. The public has a right to expect significant, measurable benefits in return. However, I think it's important that we recognize that this policy discussion is not just words and not just numbers. This is about real people and about real people's lives.
Right after I was sued on the 18th, my attorney in Atlanta, he received a call one afternoon from Beth McKenzie and Rita Ellis, who I did not know.
Beth and Rita ran an organization that advocates for abused children and were working closely with the district attorney's office. They called Charles with critical information about the lawsuit Phoebe had brought against him.
February 6, 2004, Beth and I were over at the courthouse. On the way back down, we popped by the district attorney's investigator's office.
Jim Paulx, who was the head investigator, sort of cocked back and boasted that they were doing Phoebe a favor to find out who's sending the faxes. And then he said they thought it was an insider. Later on that afternoon, I had a scheduled appointment with Ken Hodges, the district attorney, and it was in his private conference room. And Jim Paulx said to Ken, I told Beth about Phoebe. And Ken just looked up and stared. As I got up to leave, he said, I am going to call Joel Wernick to get us a building for this program. He owes me. It just didn't feel right.
And that day, in fact, we sent an email off to the Prosecutorial Association asking if it was normal procedure for a district attorney to assist a large nonprofit in a civil matter. And they kicked back an email saying, well, they found it highly irregular and no, it wasn't normal practice.
I called Rayburg, and I think the surprise that it was the DA's office that was helping get the information was they didn't say much.
Daugherty District Attorney Ken Hodges helped Phoebe Putney Hospital go after the author of the Phoebe factoids. Hodges admits he took information gained by a criminal grand jury subpoena and gave it to the hospital.
There's nothing that I've done that's unethical.
Hodges received thousands of dollars in campaign contributions from people who work for the hospital, and Hodges' wife was recently hired by Phoebe.
Mr. Rayberger, Mr. Magnano did nothing wrong. They don't have to worry about criminal prosecution. I don't understand what the worry would be if they haven't done anything wrong.
Yeah, make sure you don't have a pocket knife or something.
In December of 2005, in a completely new and stunning legal development, Charles and John were indicted on criminal charges that included 6 counts of harassing telephone calls stemming from the factoids. They, along with Jim Bowman, the investigator Dick Scruggs had hired, were also indicted on felony charges of burglary and aggravated assault. The indictment alleged that Bowman committed burglary and aggravated assault when he visited Dr. James Hodges' home. And because he went there to investigate the threats against Charles, Georgia law allowed Charles and John to be charged as if they had been there.
The aggravated assault and the burglary, the alleged victim was Jim Hodges. And what was very peculiar about those charges is that there was never an allegation and there was never any proof because Charles and John never actually were at the residence of Jim Hodges.
I've never seen him this low, this stressed. His doctor visit was bad. He was like, are you having chest pains? He said, what do you mean? He said, I mean now. I think he's afraid that we'll lose. You know, they have a lot of friends in powerful places, and I don't think it's going to happen. God would not let that happen. I don't think he'd let that happen. So
all I can think of is today. My children are going to see their father on television treated like a criminal, and that should never happen.
It's been an interesting day. I've never been processed or booked for
a crime before. That was kind of interesting.
Dr. John Bagnato surrendered at the sheriff's office at 5 o'clock this morning because he had surgeries scheduled all day. This afternoon, he issued a statement about his arrest. If speaking out against graft, greed, and corruption is now a crime in this great country of ours, we are all in big trouble. At a luncheon today, Sertoma Club member David Prezant asked Wernick several heated questions about the arrest, about board oversight of Wernick's leadership, and about hospital executives' travel expense abuses, but Wernick wouldn't answer them.
We have different views, and to me, I think the importance is the ability to disagree without being disagreeable, and I think that's what healthy debate is about.
Now, I know you've been studying this case quite a bit. I know your client's not charged with the fact of what's,
I guess. No, I haven't studied it a whole lot. You don't have to study it a whole lot.
Bobby Lee Cook was the individual that Mock, of course, was after. I can certainly see some similarities observing.
In all of my law practice, I've tried cases 37 days in three foreign countries. I have never seen a case. I have never seen a case that is as silly or useless or ridiculous as this one.
What worries me about this case is it smacks of a private criminal prosecutor, which we don't have in this country.
I mean, if I'm convicted, then I lose my medical license, and I mean, I think I'm pretty much done. So it is bothersome in that regard. I think the only way they could really convict us is by the jury, which, shoot, surely it won't go to that point. I mean, that's like Al Capone days.
The lawyers would say this is absurd. I'll never be able to convict you on this. You haven't violated any laws. But, you know, the thought that runs through your mind is being in it is absurd.
You remember Shawshank Redemption? He's going to do their taxes. I'm going to be the doctor. We'll run the library. Yeah, we've already got our jobs picked out. I mean, come on, we're set for life.
For a dismissal, the defendant found instead that they would have to wait months out.
We have nothing to hold us here. We don't have one here. We're not homegrown tomatoes or any of that kind of thing. I have a good feeling about being here.
While Charles and for their next hearing, the community began to speak out against Phoebe.
It's difficult enough to get in physicians in Southwest Georgia. It doesn't make that process any easier if the medical community are being indicted for expressing their beliefs.
The hospitals thought, particularly Phoebe, that it was just so big and awful that they could crush Dr. Bagnano Rayburg.
Whistleblowers generally are absolutely essential to Congress doing its job of oversight. I can't hire enough staff. All of Congress couldn't hire enough staff where all of the skeletons are buried in what closets. We need whistleblowers to come forth to that. And people like Rayburg and Bagnato are the best of putting everything on the line. And the retaliation that they've had, the lawsuits they've been in, prosecutions that have been attempted, is evidence of people who are patriotic or something's wrong.
These guys really are sticking it. That is, farther and farther into this by doing things that are that outrageous and that offensive to human decency.
after months of uncertainty, Judge Altman dismissed all counts of the indictment.
Obviously, Judge Altman's ruling in our favor in his order dismissing these what we consider trumped-up charges gives us a sense of measured relief. Relief that justice has prevailed, relief that my client can focus his attention and his abilities on taking care of patients, relief that the community better understands that the unholy relationship between the senior management of Phoebe and certain government officials and the harm that can flow from this type of relationship.
I just would like to say I'm very grateful to Judge Altman that he did the right thing and he ruled in our favor today. And I'm just looking forward to my family and myself having some relief from this burden.
Is it over? Or does this go on? Do they reindict us? Do they bring back other charges? Where do we go from here? And what have we really done wrong? I mean, that's ultimately the question.
Roberts, the judge in the Phoebe factoid case dismisses all the criminal charges.
Charles Rayburg and Dr. John Magnano are celebrating.
Right now, I just want to get it behind me, rest for a while, take a break, enjoy it, that I'm not indicted anymore. I'm an unindicted, at least for the time being, probably until the next grand jury meets, but I'm unindicted until next Wednesday.
It's just uncanny that it was the girl's birthday. It was great, because, you know, there they are. They hit double digits, which is a big birthday anyway. It's like, we got a birthday present, too. It was just really, we were all celebrating. Six months after the charges were dismissed, Charles settled his countersuit against Phoebe.
It definitely took a toll on Wanda and the kids, and that bothers me. Initially, she was pretty adamant about wanting the case to go to trial, but a couple of months ago, her sister passed away, and it was a time where we just kind of looked within ourselves and kind of decided that life's too short to spend it in a fight that goes on endlessly.
There you go.
John felt more and more uncomfortable working at Phoebe and eventually opened his own practice with Phoebe's only competitor in Albany, Palmyra Hospital.
The difficult part of that decision was that it forced me to leave Albany Surgical. As a result of all this Phoebe retaliation, I have a lawsuit against him. Charles has a lawsuit against the district attorney, so I'm very much still fighting.
Palmyra has since filed an antitrust lawsuit against Phoebe Putney. Joel Wernick is still the CEO of Phoebe Putney. Ken Hodges decided not to run for re-election, and instead, he joined the Baudino Law Group, which has represented Phoebe Putney for years. Both Wernick and Hodges declined to be interviewed for this film. In 2008, Dick Scruggs was convicted of attempting to bribe a judge and is now serving 5 years in a federal prison. But because of his class action lawsuits, hospitals began to change their policies.
There are 60 lawsuits pending around the country. This settlement is the first in the country between uninsured plaintiffs and a nonprofit hospital system.
Today is a big day for Oregon's uninsured. For far too long, their voices have been unheard and their rights unrecognized.
In Illinois, Resurrection Healthcare and Advocate Healthcare agreed to give refunds to nearly 400,000 needy patients who were eligible for free or discounted medical care but did not receive it. But many uninsured patients are still vulnerable. From 2003 to 2008, Maryland's nonprofit hospitals filed 132,000 lawsuits against their patients, won more than $100 million in judgments, and placed liens on more than 8,000 homes. Northwestern Memorial Hospital in Chicago spent more than $1 billion to rebuild its campus over the last decade. But in 2006, it spent less than 2% of its revenues on charity care, a fraction of what it received in tax breaks. In Washington, Senator Grassley continues to push for more oversight of nonprofit hospitals.
If these hospitals continue to press for keeping the public in the dark about how they justify $50 billion in tax breaks a year, that will greatly color my views about the need for legislation.
People are indeed having a very challenging time with paying hospital bills, particularly if they are uninsured, underinsured, indigent, or at risk.
We don't let people just die on the street for the most part in this country. So we let them to have access to our hospitals. And this debate is really about what's the best way to do that. Is it the best way to let patients incur enormous medical debt that ruins the rest of their life?
As patients look at the issue of charity care in America, they are not certain that indeed there is charity care in America.
46 million uninsured Americans can't wait any longer.
Thank you. I hope that John and Charles realize that somewhere down the line, 5-10 years from now, they realize that they did a whole lot of good for a lot of people.
Knowing how this all turned out, where I am today, I wouldn't really do anything different.
If you see something that's wrong, try to do something about it. That's really the moral of the story.
At any cost?
Hmm?
At any cost?